Now that Kerbal Space Program 2 has crested over the proverbial horizon, creative director at Star Theory, Nate Simpson, shared with us some of the secrets, hints, and teases baked into the cinematic announcement trailer to give you a better idea of what to expect in the sequel. So let's get into them. The first thing we see is the planet Kerbin, the homeworld of the Kerbals, and this small spacecraft preparing to boost to Mun, the larger of Kerbin's two moons. While this isn't actual gameplay, all of the spacecraft and base elements you see in this trailer are actual assets pulled from Kerbal Space Program 2. Though most of this spacecraft is made from familiar technologies in the original game, this engine on the end is a new metallic hydrogen engine affixed to a metallic hydrogen fuel tank, which will all have these zigzag struts as a visual indicator. Back on Earth, metallic hydrogen is still future tech, though scientists are now working on recreating it in lab conditions by using lasers to crush hydrogen with 2 to 3 million times the pressure of the Earth's atmosphere, where it stops being gas and turns into the liquid metal and potentially a fuel source one day. A little further in, we see the lander come in for an approach, the legs unfold, and it touches down where we catch a glimpse of the old Poodle engine, which has since been redesigned in KSP-1 and will likely be updated for the sequel. We get our first look at the titular Kerbals as astronaut Bob Kerman eats it coming down the ladder, ultimately destroying the lander as we pull back to see pilot Valentina Kerman taking the beautiful view of Kerbin. We hope they enjoy that view because with a totaled lander, odds are they're not getting off Mun anytime soon. Here we see what looks like a Saturn V rocket being built before more boosters are strapped to it, making it a heavy rocket in typical Kerbal fashion. In thrust, we trust. Next to it, we see the launch tower, which was actually removed because early players kept colliding with it. It's back in Kerbal Space Program 2, and here you can see a hint of the treads that will automatically move the tower out of their way. Star Theory is really trying to capture the pageantry of a launch with things like the launch tower, the flame trenches, the countdown to launch, which you can skip if you want to. You can also see some of the other buildings in the background that make up the Kerbal Space Center, and these are all in-game assets as well. A few more seconds in and we see the iconic ice falling off the rocket fuel tanks that Simpson says they want to preserve for the actual game. Here we see a quick shot of a spacecraft crashing into a nice shiny space station. Interestingly, this ISS-style space station is the kind that can still be built in orbit by launching a bunch of modules and docking them together as you did in the original game. Though there are hints of other kinds in KSP-2, but more on that in a minute. We get a quick look at a plane using a new Mark 1 cockpit and an appropriately terrified Kerbal pilot alongside this paint job. Simpson confirmed you'll be able to paint individual parts in Kerbal Space Program 2 with a primary and a secondary color. Next, we get this beautiful shot of a station in orbit around Duna, the Mars analog in Kerbal Space Program. Fun fact, if you look closely, you might notice the polar ice cap is in the wrong position in this shot. Based on the shadow, you can see Duna is rotating top to bottom, which means the pole in the axis of rotation should be on the left and right sides. Simpson said that while he spotted this inaccuracy, the marketing team wanted to keep it for cinematic purposes. In the next shot, you see a rotating habitation section on this station, and there will be a gameplay reason to choose these over the static, boring ones. A closer look shows off the rocket plane at the head of the station that's showing off more of the new painting options, before we head down to Duna's surface where you can see the planet's only moon, Ike, hanging in the sky. More importantly, there's an example of an early base here, complete with inflatable structures and solar cells accurately angled toward the source of illumination, which is important and something you'll need to consider when you're building a colony that runs on solar power, especially now that many of the celestial bodies in KSP-2 will have axial tilt, so you'll need to deal with seasonal variations as well. Of course, you'll need a rover, and this one is showcasing a new command module followed by a fun shot of a Kerbal reenacting an exciting moment from gravity. Here we see a nuclear propulsion system, essentially a nuclear bomb detonated behind this massive steel armor plate attached by shock absorbers that translate the force to the spacecraft. Though it's certainly awesome, it's not legal per se, at least on Earth, thanks to the Partial Test Ban Treaty of 1963 that prohibits nuclear detonations in the atmosphere, underwater, and in outer space. But you can go nuts in KSP-2 without worrying too much about the nuclear fallout. In this shot, we see a new kind of station in orbit above the gas giant Joule. The big revelation here is that while you can build in orbit, you'll also be able to fabricate new vehicles in orbit using these new orbital vehicle assembly buildings. So you can build vehicles of ridiculous scale without having to worry about how to propel them out of the atmosphere. This is how you unlock interstellar progression in Kerbal Space Program 2. And speaking of interstellar travel, here we get a better look at the big engine on this spacecraft, which is inspired by the Daedalus fusion drive project from the 1970s. Simpson says this engine is basically riding a tiny star inside a bucket. And this one is nowhere near as destructive as they can get down the technology tree. But since resource collection will play a big role in interstellar travel, we start to get a better idea of why this orbital base is orbiting a gas giant. Let's take a second of silence for these two Kerbals that are just straight up dead thanks to the radiation coming off that drive. Here we see an uncrewed probe with a compound engine thrusting toward the binary planets Rask and Rusk, which should provide a crazy navigational experience thanks to the gravitational tug of war. A base collapsing on the edge of a canyon, indicating we're going to see canyons and other geological formations. Kerbal screaming. As this ship decelerates, we get a look at a new planet, the ringed gas giant Glummo, and its moon, Merble. Rings are part of the stock game in Kerbal Space Program 2, and will have gameplay implications when it comes to flying by, through, or around them. Here we get a closer view of the icy Merble and its equatorial sea, along with what is a thin atmosphere you can see here and here. You can see here a cargo lander coming into the atmosphere. And here we finally get a hint at what the more permanent bases will look like as this lander touches down on a colonial vehicle assembly building. We get another look at one of the still red-hot new metallic hydrogen engines, and a great look at the new Kerbal spacesuits that are customizable to reflect team colors. A small detail, but notice all the Kerbals have different hairstyles. KSP-2 will have physical, volumetric hair that can be swapped from Kerbal to Kerbal. As the trailer comes to a close and this base comes apart at the seams, you might recognize this familiar song, M83's outro, which, in addition to becoming a movie staple, was used in the excellent Kerbal Space Program fan-made trailer called Build, Fly, Dream back in 2013. Creative director Nate Simpson said that trailer was the very first thing he shared with his team when they were given the opportunity to work on the sequel. And its creator, Sean Esau, gets a well-deserved shout-out at the end for the nod to his original. Kerbal Space Program 2 is targeting a spring 2020 landing on Xbox One, PS4, and PC. For more on this and every other video game, you're already in the right place, right here at IGN.